Jack Leynnwood was born in Los Angeles, California in 1921, and to say he would lead a colorful life was to undersell it. Jack was fortunate to grow up during the golden era of aviation and the Hollywood silver screen. He was interested in arts and mechanics. The Leynnwood family lived close to the MGM studios and Hal Roach movie studios, and young Jack periodically found himself hired as an extra in the Our Gang comedy serials, for which he was paid a whopping $18 a day, about $350 in today's money. He was also an excellent saxophone player. But above all, he was enthralled with aviation. He not only built balsa wood model airplanes, but also drew aircraft. He could frequently be found at the Culver City Municipal Airport watching airplanes. He even got to see part of the filming of the 1931 movie Helldivers. Jack wanted to be either an airline pilot or a professional musician, and at 14, he was able to earn enough money to take lessons and solo an airplane. During World War II, he became an Army Air Force fighter pilot flying P-40s and P-38s. After the war, he worked part-time and used the GI Bill to study illustration at the Art Center College of Design in Pasadena, California. According to a story by one of his later art students, one of Jack's first jobs was airbrushing out certain elements of naked people in photos for a nude magazine. It had to be done because sending pornographic material through the mail was a crime in those days. He lamented that this was all he did all day long. When the postal laws changed, he was told to go from removing certain elements to enhancing them. You do what you must to keep food on the table. After graduating from art school, Jack took a job working for the Northrop Corporation. He did illustrations of their aircraft and products, such as the F-89, T-38, and Snark missiles. These were used for their advertising and brochures. In the late 1950s, Revell Models talked to Jack about using his illustrations as box wraps. His first job was a 1:140 scale C-130A Hercules. This was later to be the start of a very long and lucrative association. As more work came his way, Jack was able to leave Northrop and become a full-time freelance artist. In the late 50s and early 60s, Revell was ready to change its look, so the art of Jack Leynnwood and John Steele began to replace the work of earlier artists such as Scott Edison and Richard Cassady. This period has been called the Second Golden Age of Revell, and by extension, model box artwork in general. Jack's artistic style continued to develop and become more sophisticated, which was essential for marketing and, in the end, for selling kits. Being an illustrator is different from being a fine artist, as the client determines the details, not the illustrator. This means constraints are placed on illustrators, and this applied to Jack as well. Revell specifically instructed Jack not to paint contemporary battle scenes, but this did not apply to events depicted in the World Wars. There was also a problem with painting World War II German aircraft, as the European market did not allow swastikas, but they had to represent the model accurately. Jack painted over 650 model kit illustrations at Revell, including ships, tanks, figures, cars, and even early spaceship and rocket kits. The illustrations appeared on box tops, catalogs, side panels, and in advertising. Jack's work was in demand, and at one point he was producing up to 5 illustrations per week. He was quite capable of knocking one out overnight. Jack did not feel compelled to include the entire airplane in some of his artwork. An example would be this illustration of the Memphis Belle, which had the wingtips out of frame. Jack felt some parts simply were not worth including. He wanted that in-your-face look, and it worked. Some of his finest work was in the 60s, when Revell introduced its 1/32nd scale World War II fighter series. Jack was given the opportunity to do the box art, and even though his preferred mediums were watercolors and oil, this series was largely painted in acrylics. Jack said that he never really liked the medium, yet did some of his best work in it. He used cropping, lighting, overlaps, and composition to create dynamic images of power, strong and impactful. This equated to excellent shelf appeal. He had achieved a new standard for quality in aviation illustration. As an aside, these are amongst my favorites of all box art. His illustration of Ravel's 1/32 scale Spitfire Mark I is my favorite box art of all time. Although illustrations better captured the romance of aviation and arguably had a stronger marketing impact, by the 1970s, manufacturers were choosing to show photographs of the finished models on the reissued kits. Some people claim this was due to avoid issues with the new truth in advertising laws, and others claim it was simply cheaper than hiring an artist. Illustrations were still being used on the newly tooled models, but that was simply because there was no photography available for the new kits. By now, Jack was doing more illustrations for kits released in Europe than in America. As the illustration market wavered, Jack still needed to make a living, so he did other illustrations, and there was plenty of work to be done, largely in movie posters, including the 1975 movie Midway, Jaws 2, Airport 77, and Gray Lady Down, amongst other less notable movies. He even did a dramatic poster for a re-release of Hell's Angels. Jack later became a teacher of illustration, and the following is a story from one of his students. Someone had made a comment about art, and Jack's abrupt reply was, "We're not talking art here. I do illustration. I don't do art. You want to do art? You want to go to Otis and sit around in the lotus position and throw bananas at canvas and call it art? Go on. Go right ahead. I'll be laughing all the way to the bank. Laughing all the way to the bank." And speaking of bank, Jack did very well. As a result, he was able to enjoy his hobbies such as flying and collecting Jaguar automobiles. Jack technically retired, and he and his wife eventually moved from Los Angeles to Sedona, Arizona. But Jack stayed busy painting, and he led an active life to include flying. His career spanned 50 years, and his list of clients is extensive. His art graces the box tops of Ravel, Aurora, Aero Publishers, Northrop, United Technologies, Hughes Aircraft, and even Rutan Aircraft. His art truly does capture the spirit and romance of aviation. In 1999, Jack passed away. Kit model packaging was always targeted at boys, with zooming aircraft and lots of action. When I was a kid, I would revel in the chance to buy a model kit that I had watched for weeks. That is how the work of these box top artists affected me. I never met Jack Leynnwood, but his work touched my life. Did it touch yours?
Nothing but blue skies
overhead
from now on.
Best.